Let's wait for everybody to join in on this colloquium. I see the number of participants is increasing as the capable Zoom servers allow the connections. 3 people per second. Okay. So maybe we can start and people will keep joining as the first minutes go. It's a great pleasure for us to have today Professor Pablo Debenedetti from Princeton University. He will be giving this Zoom ICTP colloquium today. And just a quick bio sketch. Professor Debenedetti is one of the world leaders in the study of metastable liquids, which we'll tell us about today. He's a class of 1950 professor in engineering and applied science, and professor of chemical and biological engineering, and dean of research. He joined the faculty of Princeton University more than 30 years ago, and among his many professional honors, he is a member of the National Academy of Engineering, the American Academy of Arts and Science, the National Academy of Science, and is fellow of the American Institute of Chemical Engineers, the American Association for Advancements of Science, and the American Physical Society. And he wrote a very nice book called Metastable Liquids. Atish is here. Okay, very good. So we also have the director. So it was I was doing the honors.
No, thank you. Thank you. Actually, yeah. There was some issue with my Zoom link. So I...
We got continue. Used to this now, yes. After a year and a half. Okay, so I was just telling the audience that Professor Debenedetti is a great expert in metastable liquids, and I was just making a list of the many, many honors that that he has achieved in his career. Unless you want to say
something. I joined you from the beginning, but I'm very pleased actually. Let me say on behalf of ICTP that we are very pleased to have Professor Pablo Debenedetti here. My colleague Antonella has already given an introduction to his many achievements. As I understand, his last visit to ICTP was in 2004. On some activity in glass physics as a speaker. So it would have been nice to welcome him here in person, but maybe hopefully sometime in the future, we can bring him back to ICTP.
Thank you.
Okay, so...
Please go ahead. Antonella.
Yours, and you can share the screen and start the presentation. One notice to the audience: there is a Q&A window where you can ask questions that will be moderated, and if relevant. Asked to Professor Debenedetti during his talk. I suppose you don't mind being interrupted every now and then.
Not a problem. Not a problem, Antonello. As you said, I cannot see the questions when I'm sharing my screen, so you can forward them to me. Hopefully that will work. But anyway, it's a real honor and a pleasure to join you this morning or this afternoon for you. I'm going to be talking about the thermodynamics of liquid water below the melting point or below the freezing point. This is a subject that has caught the interest of physicists, chemists, atmospheric scientists, and biophysicists for more than half a century. for reasons that I will explain. And it is an area where computer simulations have played a very important role. And I will explain why that is the case. So I will begin with presenting some experimental facts about supercooled water and introduce the so-called liquid-liquid phase transition hypothesis. And then I'll talk about three works, very recent, one in which we find clear evidence of a second critical point in two classical but very realistic models of water. One in which we obtain evidence consistent with, again, a second critical point in an ab-initio neural network model of water. And the third, more recent work in which we find an intriguing connection between criticality and the long-range structure of glassy phases of water. And I will end with conclusions. So just to put everyone on the same playing field, we all know that at atmospheric pressure, liquid water is stable between the melting and the boiling point. But if you're a good experimentalist, you can keep water in the liquid state above the boiling point. That is called superheated water. And the world's record to which this has been achieved is 180 degrees above the boiling point. On the other hand, you can cool water below the freezing point. That's what I'm going to be talking about today, and maintain it in the liquid state. And that can be done up to now, up to minus 44 degrees C. You see that these lines that I'm talking about are dotted, not fixed, because they are dictated not by thermodynamics, but by kinetics. And therefore, it's the interaction of thermodynamics and kinetics and your own experimental ingenuity that dictates how metastable you can be. Water, like any liquid, cooled sufficiently fast, can form a glass. If you heat that glass, there is a glass transition. Above that, you have spontaneous crystallization to cubic ice. And I'm going to be talking a lot about the properties of water in this region, where water is cold enough that it tends to spontaneously freeze upon cooling, but also hot enough that it tends to freeze upon heating from below, devitrifying. So it's very challenging to observe metastable liquid under these conditions. Supercooled water is not just a laboratory curiosity. The greatest inventory exists in clouds. So here I show you schematically the temperature profiles in the atmosphere, and I'm going to be concentrating on the troposphere, which is the lower 11 to 12 kilometers where weather happens. Because the Earth is much better at absorbing solar radiation than the gases in the atmosphere, the troposphere is heated from below, so we promptly, it's very easy at sufficient altitude to reach sub-freezing conditions. And because of the relative paucity of efficient ice nucleating particles, it's very common to see droplets of water supercooled in clouds. At temperatures below minus 30 degrees C, the freezing, when it happens homogeneously without the need of solid particles. At relatively higher temperatures, it happens heterogeneously, catalyzed by solid particles. And there is a lot of supercooled water. Here I show you the major inventories of water on Earth. If you look at the left-hand column, I've translated everything to the radius of an equivalent sphere. If we condense all the water in liquid form, you could see that we would have a sphere of radius of 9 miles, representing all the water that is in the atmosphere, not all of it in the form of liquid droplets, of course, a lot of it in the form of water vapor. The properties of supercooled water are highly unusual. The pioneering work here was done by the late Austin Angel that passed away recently. Here I show the isothermal compressibility, that is the response of density to changes in pressure. And whereas most liquids, when you cool them, the compressibility does nothing interesting, in water, it really shoots up but continues increasing as far as one can measure. And a few years later, they did similar measurements for the heat capacity, which is the response function for the entropy or for the enthalpy. And again, highly unusual behavior. You can see that the more you supercool, the higher the heat capacity becomes. And if you're interested in thermodynamics and statistical mechanics, this really gets your juices flowing, because these are response functions that cannot keep increasing by themselves. Something needs to happen. And the key question in this field is, what is about to happen? What is water tending to? The properties of supercooled water, all of them are unusual. The most well-known is probably the density maximum, the fact that below 4 degrees C, the density decreases instead of increasing upon cooling, in sharp contrast to the behavior of a simple liquid. Here I show the thermal expansion coefficient, which not only becomes negative, but the rate at which its magnitude increases continues to increase sharply upon supercooling. The heat capacity increases dramatically, and I just told you that, and the compressibility also increases, all in sharp contrast to the behavior of a simple liquid. And microscopically, each of these response functions is associated with a fluctuation. So supercooled water is unusual because there is a negative correlation between entropy and volume fluctuations. The heat capacity increase indicates an increase in enthalpy fluctuations. The compressibility increase indicates an increase in density fluctuations. So what is water fluctuating between? That is a question that one seeks to answer. A very important step in the, at least the formulation of a governing hypothesis, was taken in 1992, in this pioneering work in the group of Gene Stanley, done by then graduate student Peter Poole, working with then postdoc Francesco Shortino. If I could concentrate your attention on the curves denoted by liquid, they were studying the equation of state of supercooled water. And so the expectation is that as you lower the volume, as you compress the liquid, the pressure will start increasing sharper and sharper. But as you can see, as they decrease the temperature, all of a sudden they observe exactly the opposite. The liquid became highly compressible, as you can see by an almost horizontal portion of the curves. In fact, if you take this with a grain of salt, but look carefully, this looks almost like the beginnings of a van der Waals loop. Notice that this is not a typographical mistake. The pressure is decreasing at constant density as we increase the temperature. That's one of the anomalies of water. It's related to the fact that the thermal expansion coefficient in this region is negative. And if you very rapidly quench and form a glass on the computer and then compress the glass, instead of going continuously from a low density to high density, you see almost a sharp discontinuity. And so this led these authors to propose the bold hypothesis that they were approaching a liquid-liquid transition, a metastable liquid-liquid transition, and perhaps a critical point, as you would have if you had a van der Waals loop in this region. This experiment, this work, is remarkable because it's one of the few instances where a computer simulation preceded the experimental result. 2 years later, Osamu Mishima did a remarkable set of experiments in which he compressed so-called low-density amorphous ice. This is the glass that you form by cooling liquid water very fast. And when you compress, you see that the volume decreases almost through a first order phase transition. Of course, these are metastable phases. They're out of equilibrium. When you do a cycle, there's here low density amorphous ice, high density amorphous ice, you see hysteresis. I see here a question. Let me see. The question that was asked to me is, how does water remain liquid when the temperatures increase more than 100 degrees? Well, water is metastable. That's the answer. And the way to do that experiment is, for example, by putting liquid water in an immiscible fluid in which it rises, and continue to heat the immiscible fluid in which water rises. And the absence of a sharp interface with respect to a solid allows water to be superheated. And that has been done in the lab, and you can do it up to 180 degrees C. So I hope I answered that question. But returning to this slide, Mishima did the experiment exactly what I showed in the computer simulation, except that here it's rotated by 90 degrees because he manipulated the pressure, not the volume. In the simulations, they manipulated the volume, not the pressure. And so this led to the formulation of the so-called liquid-liquid transition hypothesis for water, which I show here, that says that deep in the supercooled region below the homogeneous nucleation temperature, but above the glass transition temperature, there is a metastable liquid-liquid transition terminating at a critical point. And that critical point is the origin of all the anomalies that you saw experimentally measured. That is the increase in heat capacity, the increase in compressibility. Of course, observing this has been a challenge, and I'm going to show you a list of experimental papers. The preponderance of the evidence is certainly consistent with the existence of the critical point, but we don't have what we would call in the US a smoking gun, that is a completely definitive proof. And part of it is the difficulty in observing liquid water without crystallizing in this region. On the other hand, in computer simulations, it's very easy to supercool and avoid crystallization. So computer simulations provide a complementary set of characteristics that make this problem very challenging to study, but very appropriate to study by computer simulation, because the characteristic times for relaxation and freezing are very well separated. And so computer simulations have played a crucial role in exploring the possibility of the existence of this liquid-liquid transition and a critical point. Again, the main idea, as we know from the theory of critical phenomena, the presence of a critical point is always felt not just in the immediate vicinity of the critical point, but very far away. And it is hypothesized that it is this critical point that give rise to this unusual behavior. Here I show a list of experimental papers that are consistent with liquid-liquid transition. You can all see this. I don't expect you to memorize all this. This talk is being recorded. The point that I want to make, these are not the titles of the papers. These are the techniques that were used in any case. And there is a wide variety of techniques, all of which, if you read these papers, show very clear evidence that is very consistent with the existence of a critical point. So let me now begin with the first piece of work from our lab that I want to talk about. I'm going to be talking about simulations of a classical model, two models called TIP4P2005, TIP4PIs. They belong to a family of rigid body models of water with localized charges, but these have the characteristics that they are very realistic. In fact, they do a fairly good job at representing the very complex solid phase diagram of water, which is a highly non-trivial thing to do. And so I'm going to show you results of calculations in which we measured density and energy fluctuations and analyzed the results in light of the theory of critical phenomena. So this is the raw data. I have the simulations of TIP5P and TIP4P2005, TIP4PIs, close to what will turn out to be their metastable second critical point. And you notice that the density is doing something very curious. Instead of oscillating around an equilibrium value, it's fluctuating between two equilibrium values. And that's, this, of course, is the signature of a vicinity to a phase transition. For those of you who do simulations, I want you to notice the extremely long times, 40 microseconds. So simulations on the order of tens of microseconds are necessary in order to collect good statistics. And using the techniques that I'm going to explain in the next slide, we're able to convert this to smooth two-dimensional probability distribution diagrams for density and energy fluctuations at the critical points. And these are, again, metastable critical points because these are highly supercooled conditions. So how do we obtain the values of the critical point? We use a technique called histogram reweighting. I'll explain in words and then I'll take you through these equations. In words, the idea is if you're interested in the statistics of the distribution of an order parameter, and in an isobaric simulation, an order parameter could be the fluctuating density or the fluctuating energy, then what you do is you collect histograms of the value of these fluctuating order parameters. And you approximate the true distribution by the collection of histograms. You weigh the histograms with statistical weights, and then you require that you minimize the deviation between the histograms that you collected and the true distribution of the order parameter. And when you do that, you end up with a set of coupled equations where I, going from I to R, are the thermodynamic conditions under which you do simulations. F sub I is the histogram in the I thermodynamic condition that has values of volume equal to V and energy equal to E. This gives you the probability distribution of observing the order parameter at conditions P and T. F is simply the total number of observations or configurations in simulation I. And C is an effective free energy defined here. So these two equations need to be solved in a coupled numerical way. And when you do that, you will see here, I show you a collection of extrapolated histograms. Essentially, they allow you to extrapolate the histograms of a fluctuating quantity away from the conditions at which you're simulating. In this series of curves, the symbols denote simulations. The curves are calculated histograms. And you see that the technique works extremely well. These are a series of isothermal simulations at a series of pressures going from 1.5 kilobars to 2 kilobars. And what you see, what the system is doing, it's evolving from a low density to a high density as you increase the pressure, that's expected. But instead of doing it continuously, it goes through a clear region of a phase transition because you have a very broad distribution and in fact you have bimodality. And so this again indicates the existence of a phase transition and the proximity to a critical point. We wanted to really qualify and understand what type of criticality we had. And of course, when you have short-range interactions and a scalar order parameter, the default thing that you look for is the Ising universality class. As shown by Wilding, the relevant order parameter is a linear combination of density and energy. Here, S is a field mixing parameter, it's not the entropy, and T is simply the combined, linearly combined order parameter. So this is because of the lack of particle hole symmetry in a real fluid, manifested by the breakdown, for example, of the law of rectilinear diameters. And we use the very useful parametrization, very accurate but empirical parametrization of the distribution of magnetization fluctuations due to Sipin and Blöte, who fitted this to the universal Ising distribution. And we compare it with our own observed fluctuation distributions for the rescaled value of this mixed order parameter defined such that it has zero mean and unit variance. And so really what you do is you compare the observed fluctuations, you regress the temperature and the pressure that give you the best fit to the Ising universality class and from which you obtain the critical parameters. So the green curve here is the universal Ising distribution and the dots are the observed distributions in the simulations. And you can see that you get a very good approximation to the Ising model. And you can regress values of the critical parameter using this technique. So this gives you clear proof that indeed the fluctuations correspond to a critical point of the Ising universality class. In this same work, we did a second calculation. So we simulated a scattering experiment. We calculated the structure factor. The structure factor is related in the K equals zero.
Pablo, can I interrupt you a second?
Yes, please.
Yes. So regarding this Ising symmetry graph. So since you said there is no particle hole symmetry, it's like in the Ising model when you have an external magnetic field, right?
Yes.
So and so you are following you are looking at the transition, the first order transition along that line and getting closer to the critical point.
Actually, the line is at the critical point and the fit of the curves are the best fit that you can get to the distribution where you are regressing. Of course, the fit will be different at different temperatures and pressures. So you're regressing the best fit for the critical temperature and the critical pressure. It's a numerical fit to the icing distribution.
Okay, very good. I was just asking, I mean, at the critical point, the icing model has critical exponents and everything.
I will show you, that's where I'm going. I will show you the exponents.
Okay, very good. So this fit is just for the distribution of the magnetization, and then you will,
exactly,
you will show for the correlations. Okay.
Sorry. Exactly. So we calculate the structure factor, which is related to the compressibility in the k equals zero limit. We use the fact that close to the critical point, the structure factor can be decomposed into a normal and an anomalous component. The anomalous component has a Lorentzian form where chi is the correlation length, k is the wave vector. And we do simulations with a very large system. So we have, in this case, these are very expensive simulations on the order of 50,000 molecules, exactly 36,000. Why so many? Because we want to measure the correlation length and we want to make sure that our computational box contains several correlation lengths. And so we fix the density and we converge to the expected critical point. And you can see very clearly the enhanced fluctuations given by the growth in the structure, in the low K value of the structure factor. And so here's the question that you were asking. These are the predictions from, if you have a system that satisfies the icing universality class, these are the icing critical exponents. So we took our numerical data for the correlation length and the compressibility. And here we show a line with a slope fixed by the predictions of the critical exponents of the icing universality class and the critical temperature as the regress parameter. And you can see that within numerical accuracy, this is also very consistent with the icing universality class. It's as good as you can do in the simulations. These are extremely demanding simulations, both because of the size of the computational cell and because of critical slowing down. So you need to run extremely long simulations, but very satisfyingly, the critical temperature that we regress is very consistent with what we obtain by doing the icing fit. So this first piece of work shows the existence of a metastable critical point in two models that do a very good job at representing the properties of water. But these models are empirical. So the question is, can we do better than this? There's no question that simulations have helped us gather insights into the behavior of water, and there are many, many, many examples. It's a very active field. Can we do the same? Can we improve and say something about the behavior of water in this region that I've been talking about, but using ab-initio type models or ab-initio type calculations? Until very recently, the answer to this would have been no because of the very long times required for relaxation and comparatively large sample sizes. So I'm going to show you in this work how using a combination of machine learning, computational chemistry, and statistical mechanics, we are able to develop an ab-initio quality model without adjustable parameters. And this model shows behavior consistent with the existence of a metastable critical point. So the development of the model involves generation of a deep neural network model of water with training data prepared with a scan at the density functional theory level with a scan exchange correlation functional. We train so as to reproduce ab initio energies and forces. And we use deep potential molecular dynamics in the multi-thermal, multibaric ensemble to generate the equation of state. I'll go into those details in a second. We do the initial training doing density functional theory calculations on a small number of configurations involving both the liquid and 15 ice phases, and add new training data by iterative exploration of configurational space. And here are the details. We ended up having roughly 20,000 structures in the final training set. And so this model was then obtained in this iterative fashion. So how does this work? So I'm going to show you the predictions of the model. I want you to concentrate on the top left figure. Here I'm showing the height of the second peak of the oxygen-oxygen pair correlation function, where the diamonds are experimental data and the circles are simulations. And you see very good agreement. In order to obtain this good agreement, we had to shift the simulation data by 47 Kelvin. But once we do that, we obtain a good, fairly good representation of the properties of supercooled water. And these are highly non-trivial predictions. Remember, there are no adjustable parameters here. And in fact, we're able to reproduce both the density maximum. Again, diamonds are simulations, circles are experiments. So this is one of water's anomalies. The diffusion anomaly, if you notice, the diffusion goes up with pressure when water is cold. That's another of water's anomaly. Both the increasing diffusivity and the decrease in viscosity upon pressurization are distinctive anomalies of liquid water. And here we show the anomalous increase in compressibility. Once we shift the temperatures, the model does a very good job at 1 kilobar. It does a good job at moderate supercooling, but not as good a job at deep supercooling at 1 bar. The remaining sources of discrepancy, and this is an active area of investigation, could involve nuclear quantum effects, since the nuclei are treated classically, or limitations of the density functional theory. But this is the model that we're going to use. Even with this, even though it runs much faster than an ab initio molecular dynamics, it is still too slow for the problem that we're interested in, because you can only sample if you use straightforward molecular dynamics, the immediate vicinity of the point at which you're simulating. So you'd like to be able to enhance the fluctuations of volume and energy and sample a broader range of configurations. So we use the technique of multithermal multibaric ensemble developed in Michele Parinello's group. Pablo Piaggi is a co-author of this paper that, again, enhances, by adding a bias to the potential, enhances the fluctuations in volume and energy. And essentially what you're doing is you're reweighting what you observe to other conditions denoted here by T prime and P prime. So these are the results. In the left panel, I show you the equation of state. This is density versus temperature at various pressures. And though it's very difficult to see, I'm actually showing two sets of data. The data that are reweighted by this multithermal multibaric ensemble and the data obtained by MPT simulations. You see that they're almost indistinguishable. And the model is showing a low temperatures and vastly enhanced fluctuations, which you can see by an increase in the slope of rho versus P. Here we take the derivatives and we calculate the compressibility. And you notice lines through the points. And so what we use to get the lines through the points is a phenomenological thermodynamic model called two-state thermodynamics. What happens in supercooled water is that molecules can be very easily distinguished by the local configurations in a computer simulation. And these tend to be bimodal. Either a molecule has a local environment that is tetrahedrally coordinated and low density, or the tetrahedral is highly distorted with the invasion of a fifth neighbor, for example, and high density. So you can easily classify the water molecules in one or two environments. So you develop a so-called mixture model where X is the fraction of water that has a low density environment. You postulate an ideal entropy of mixing with some interaction that reflects the non-ideality. But what I want to stress is that when I use the word mixture here is in quotation marks, because this is not a true mixture, it's a single component. The fraction of molecules that have a low density environment is obtained by minimization of the Gibbs free energy. It's not imposed a priori. So you postulate an expansion between the difference in free energy between water molecules that have low density and high density environments. Omega in general is 2. You can easily see by taking two derivatives, since this model is symmetric by the exchange x to 1 minus x, that at omega equals 2, you have a critical point. And you make this more general. You make the interaction energy temperature dependent. So you have a series of adjustable parameters, which you obtain by fitting the model to the simulation data, for example, for the fraction of water molecules that have a low density environment. I see a question. So the question is, what do GA and GB pertain to in the first equation of two-state thermodynamics? GA and GB are the chemical potential of free energy per molecule of a water molecule that has a low density local environment and a high density local environment. So they are the precursors of the two different liquid phases. And when you do that, you obtain very good fit to simulation data. This is earlier work, but for our model, these are the fits. You can see that you obtain excellent fit to the simulation data. We had to stop at this temperature because of the low temperature, long relaxation times. But you can see that the fit through the model predicts, again, demixing and the existence of a liquid-liquid critical point, in this case at 224 Kelvin. And you subtract, remember, to the 47 degree shift, you get a pretty decent agreement with our previous predictions. The important thing here is that this is whereas before this was a rigorous proof, albeit numerical, here the simulations stop at a temperature below the critical point exists below the temperature that we simulated in this work. But nonetheless, the fit is very satisfactory and is strong evidence consistent with, again, the existence of a metastable critical point in this model.
Pablo, can I stop you for a second? So just to understand a little bit, so GA and GB are essentially fitting parameters for they're not found microscopically. You're using your two-state model to find these delta P, delta T, which are essentially GA minus GB from the data.
So I postulate that GA minus GB has an expansion in temperature and pressure, and what I obtain are the coefficients, okay? And what I measure in my simulations is X, that is to say, at any given point, I do simulations, I can, by using a certain classification of when a molecule has a low density local environment and a high density local environment, at any given TMP, I know what X is. So that gives me a parameter to fit, and I obtain with this the parameters of the model. And that then gives me the lines.
But also TC is a fitting parameter. Right?
Exactly.
And so from that, so when GB and GA are equal, for the temperature which they are equal and pressure for which they are equal, that's the point of the phase transition. That's the red circle there.
That's the locus of the phase transition. In fact, that condition defines the critical point and the continuation, which is the Widom line when GA is equal to GB.
Okay. So just to make clear to the audience and myself.
Thank you. And once you have that, then you can do excellent fit to the simulation. So here we have the predicted critical point. This is a line of maximum density. The symbols are the simulations. The line is the predicted fit, the two-state fit. The same thing with the maximum of heat capacity, the maximum of compressibility. They merge at the critical point as they should. So this gives you essentially control of the whole thermodynamics. But as I said, our simulations numerically stop at 250, and the critical point is predicted to be below that. So the last topic that I want to talk takes us back to the glasses. So I want to remind you of the basic phenomenology that I showed, a low density glass and a high density glass. And these clearly are non-equilibrium phases. And we became very interested in the connection between glasses and criticality by a very interesting paper by Sal Torquato, Fausto Martelli, Nicolas Giovan Battista, and Roberto Carr of a few years ago. They did numerical calculations on water glasses and showed that the glasses were what Sal has come to call hyperuniform. That is to say that rather than having the structure factor go to infinity, as I showed before, denoting enhanced long-range fluctuations, they see the opposite effect. The structure factor that goes to zero, or that is very small, denoting an anomalous suppression of density fluctuations. So then we ask the question, something really interesting is happening here, because you go from S equals zero to a diverging S of zero. And so the change in the structure of the glass perhaps could reflect passage close to the critical point. So we decided to investigate this numerically by doing the following computational experiments, that is quenching water glasses, and we're going to be using the TIP4P2005 at different pressures, and see if something unusual happens to glasses formed at pressures that cross the critical pressure that we previously calculated. And obviously the answer is yes, otherwise I wouldn't be talking about this. And so the rest of the talk, I want to show you some interesting results. Now we wanted to have a comparison as to the expected behavior. So we use three models. One is this TIP4P2005. The other one is a very popular coarse grain model of water that doesn't have a liquid-liquid transition. It's a single side model developed and used very successfully by Valeria Molinero that enforces tetrahedrality by a three body term. So this is intermediate in the sense that it has all of water's anomalies, but doesn't have a metastable critical point. And then something that is a canonical glass former. It's a mixture of Leonard Jones with different energy and size parameters. It's called the Cobb-Anderson mixture. It's a canonical glass former. It's very difficult to crystallize and very easy to form glasses, but has no reason to form, to display any of water's anomalies. So we quench these at different pressures and measure the structure factor. So this is the Cobb-Anderson binary Leonard Jones. So what you see on the right hand side is the numerical calculation of something called the spectral density, which denotes volume fraction fluctuations. It's analogous to the structure factor. So again, we're quenching isobarically. The red is the initial temperature, blue denotes the final temperature. And nothing unusual happens in the structure factor. As we change the pressure, you see reduced fluctuations as you increase the pressure, the behavior that you would expect. For MW, you see the same, although there's an interesting non-monotonicity, but basically you see the same qualitative behavior as in the Cobb-Anderson mixture. But for water, or for at least for the TIP4P model of water, you see very interesting and very different behavior. So the structure factor, the k equals zero limit of the structure factor, shows pronounced enhancements in the glass phase, very close to the pressure where we calculated that there is a critical point. So this was very intriguing to us because it's telling us that the glass shows remnants of long-range density fluctuations that originate by being close to the critical point. So we decided to look at this more carefully. So here I show you the same information, but I'm showing you the structure factor as it evolves during the quench of the liquid to the glassy phase. You see that both at low pressures and at very high pressures, the trend is monotonic. You see a decrease in the structure factor. But at intermediate pressures close to the critical point, as you supercool the liquid, the structure factor starts to increase, and then it's frozen into the glass. So then the question that drove this investigation is what we see a sign of fluctuations being frozen upon crossing the Widom line? Now, the Widom line, I alluded to it before, is the locus of maximum correlation lengths. Every critical point has a Widom line emanating from it. And the line of maximum compressibilities and maximum heat capacities asymptotically become the Widom line asymptotically close to the critical point. So we decided to look at that. And the question we are asking is, how does the glass transition influence these phenomena? So we computed here the glass transition of this TIP4P 2005 water model for different cooling rates. As you lower the cooling rate, the glass transition dips lower. That's basic phenomenology. But you see one more of water's anomalies. You see two types or two families of glass transition. At lower pressures, you have water-like anomalous behavior in that the glass transition temperature decreases as you pressurize the fluid, whereas at high pressure, the glass transition increases as you pressurize the fluid. This is the normal behavior that you see in any liquid. This is telling you that as you compress the liquid, the molecules gain mobility, if you want to speak loosely. And that is because at low density, water forms a very open, low density, tetrahedrally coordinated network. This is the critical point that we calculated, and you see that the glass transition line computed at the lowest cooling rate that we attained in the simulations is close to but below the critical temperature. So even though today I talk very little about dynamics, I want you to notice that this point has a combination of critical slowing down. It is also metastable with respect to a crystal, so you have to worry about nucleation, and it is also close to the glass transition. So dynamics here is extremely rich and very interesting. So here I'm showing you the structure factor as a function of pressure for these points, and you see that as you, at different cooling rates, you see a maximum. As you lower the cooling rates, the maximum becomes sharper. And at the lowest cooling rate that we could see, this maximum coincides with the critical pressure. And within numerical accuracy, these maxima correspond to points along the Widom line emanating with the critical point. So the physical picture is extremely rich and attractive and is summarized here. As you cool a liquid at constant pressure, you're quenching, and then you're going to freeze the fluctuations, the maximum fluctuations that you see when you cool and the glass transition intersects the Widom line. Those are the fluctuations that are being frozen, and that's why you see signatures of criticality, because if you're able to cool at a rate, excuse me, such that the glass transition lies below the critical point, you will preserve the fluctuations that you see in passing through the critical point. This is extremely intriguing because it suggests an experimental access to the possible existence of critical point by studying the long-range structure of glasses as a function of pressure. And I'm collaborating with Thomas Lerting at Innsbruck, where he was doing experiments trying to see if we see this effect. So summarizing the behavior of the glass transition that we saw for the Cobb-Anderson mixture, normal liquid behavior. For MW, you see water-like behavior, but you don't see an anomalous increase in the structure factor corresponding to passage through a critical point. But for TIP4P, you see both water-like behavior in the sense of having a low-density branch and a high-density branch with different pressure dependence of the glass transition line, but also along this branch, an anomalous increase in the long range density fluctuations in the glass. So let me summarize the implications of the third part, the third calculation that I talked about. The long range structure of water-like TIP4P 2005 glasses shows a surprising signature of metastable criticality. NW model exhibits water-like anomalies in TG, shows two branches, but no evidence of a liquid-liquid transition. And we hypothesize that the low wave vector limit of the structure factor and its pressure dependence may distinguish between systems that have a liquid-liquid phase transition and those that don't. And so it could be maybe an experimentally accessible metric that does not rely on having to observe liquid water without crystallizing in this region. So let me summarize the conclusions of what I told you. Both TIP4P2005 and TIP4PIs possess a second critical point. We see signatures of liquid-liquid phase transition in an ab-initio deep neural network model of water. I've shown you long-range structure of TIP4P2005 glasses showing signatures of criticality. And the intriguing concept that the intersection of the Widom line and the glass transition line freezes long-range structure in glasses. I don't want you to leave this talk with the impression that I'm saying that real water has a critical point, a second critical point. This will need to be determined by experiments, but some of the experimental evidence, the papers that I listed in that single slide, is very compelling and consistent with the existence of criticality. But again, the definitive proof will have to come from experiments, not from simulations. We don't have a systematic understanding of how force fields affect and shift the liquid-liquid transition. I alluded to the fact that dynamics is extremely rich. We're starting to explore it. There is a confluence of critical slowing down, nucleation, and vitrification. I didn't talk today about scaling and universality, but there are several features associated with a second critical point that allow considerable collapse of very different models, provided you do the right scaling. And I do want to end by really acknowledging the people who did this work on the metastable criticality. This is my postdoc, Gul Cerce, and I've had the pleasure of collaborating with Francesco Shortino in Rome. On the deep neural network model, postdoc Thomas Gartner and Pablo Piaggi, former postdoc Linfeng Zhang, and this was a collaboration with Thanos Panagiotopoulos and Roberto Carr. And the work on water glasses, again, the work of Thomas Gartner, collaboration with Roberto Carr and Sal Torquato, funding of National Science Foundation and Department of Energy, and we made abundant use of the Princeton supercomputing resources. So I really want to thank you for your attention, and I'm very happy to try to answer any questions you may have. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks, Pablo, for the beautiful talk. So we do have one question, which was asked by Stefano Baroni, and but to be asked at the end of the talk, as instructed. Can you read it, or should I read it to you?
Yes.
Okay. So if you can read it, you can also answer it.
It says, in one of your first slides, you showed us the time evolution of density or energy fluctuations featuring soliton-like jumps. I presume these data were from isothermal isobaric simulations, which are designed to yield correct equilibrium properties, but not necessarily dynamical ones. Have you got any idea on how the details of these results depend on the specific thermostat and barostat employed in the simulation? So we did vary thermostat and barostat at the outset of the project. The equilibrium results, as long as you use physically meaningful parameters for the thermostat and barostat, do not depend on the values. Of course, the dynamics of the fluctuations do depend on that, but the calculation that we were doing is trying to obtain the equilibrium distribution two-dimensional histogram of energy and density fluctuations. And so those are provided you use physical values for the parameters independent of the barostat and thermostat constants.
So So we say we answer this question. So Ali, you have a question.
Yes, if I can steal this opportunity. So thanks very much, Pablo. So I had a curiosity about, so, you know, comparing the classical potentials versus the deep neural network model. Let's say from the deep neural network, of course, it's trained with all the full electronic polarization, et cetera, et cetera. Do you have a sense on, you know, when you talk about the high density, low density fluctuations, is there some interesting coupling going on with dielectric fluctuations as well? And is that something that could be teased out from?
We did not look at that. It certainly is something that could be teased out. We were interested in equation of state calculations, but it could. Let me, I do want to clarify something. I hope you don't mind taking a cue from your question. I don't want to sound as though I'm overselling the deep neural network model when I said there's no adjustable parameters, because of course, you know, what points you use for the training set, how many layers you use in your neural network, those are in a sense parameters, but there's no assumption as to the model. You know, you're collecting data, doing a neural network fit of the model, and this is what you get. So it is very nice to see that you're able to reproduce the water anomalies already. I would imagine, and we're doing work in that direction, that training a neural network with more points and more ice phases will give you more accurate model and hopefully lead to the elimination or the narrowing of this 47 Kelvin gap between theory and experiment.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
I do have a question about that 47 Kelvin gap. So that's a few millielectron volt in energy, right? So you said you were expecting that to come from, you know, nuclear effect, quantum effects. Which kind of can you elaborate a little bit more on what?
Well, in these simulations, you treat the nuclei. I mean, you're doing electronic structure calculations, and the nuclei are treated classically. I'm not an expert in DFT calculation, but in the method, you're treating the nuclei classically, and they're not. And so, if you do path integral simulations, and people have done that, and there are people who have quantified very accurately how much of this comes from nuclear quantum effects. Mm-hmm. Now, the answer is model specific, so one would have to do calculations for the specific model that we train. And you're using a particular functional called the scan functional. That is a good functional, it's not an exact functional, so there are sources of error there. So these are the possible sources of error that we have.
So, but physically the idea is that part of the energy goes into degrees of freedom that you have not considered.
Exactly.
Okay, so you are
And this would become particularly relevant at low temperatures, which is the region that I'm interested in. You know, if I were doing vapor liquid equilibrium, it would be different.
I understand. Okay. Somebody has raised his hand. Can I ask to write, because I cannot let the people talk, but you can write your question in the Q&A thing, please?
I think it's in the panel now, so you can talk. Yeah.
Ah, okay. Now it's in the panel. Yeah. Okay. So
do you hear me?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot for the talk. It was really, really interesting. I have a very naive question. So structurally, these high and low density liquids. So I at a certain point in the talk, you mentioned a fifth coordinated structure with respect to a fourth coordinated structure. So did you characterize them structurally? And if that's the case, so how long do they live? Which is the lifetime of a molecule in the surrounded by a high density environment, solvation shell, and another one solvated by a low density solvation shell?
Thank you. That's an excellent question, because I didn't have time to go into the detail. Let me start the difference in structure. So the low density liquid, every molecule is tetrahedrally coordinated, but you don't have long range orders. So you don't have like hexagonal eyes. So you think of tetrahedra that are orientationally disordered, okay? In the high density liquid, if you look at the structure, first of all, you have a local higher density because there is like a fifth neighbor that typically intrudes into the first coordination shell. So there are many ways of distinguishing this. Some people use as an order parameter the distance to the fifth neighbor. In the low density liquid, that distance is higher than in the high density liquid. That's one order parameter. Another order parameter is to measure the height between the first and second peaks of the oxygen-oxygen pair correlation function. For the low density liquid, that almost goes to zero. So you have a very good separation between the first and second solvation shell. In the high density liquid, that is corrupted. Now, regarding the lifetime, in a computer simulation, If you have a model that allows you to see liquid-liquid coexistence, and that's a non-trivial aspect because you're talking very low temperatures, you need to let it equilibrate. But one such model is one that I didn't talk about today called ST2. You can see the phases coexist for a very long time. When I say very long time, I mean simulation time. These phases will coexist for tens of microseconds at the right conditions. Now, if you're asking for the individual molecule, a given configuration in a thermalized fluid, that's fluctuating all the time. It's a few picoseconds. So before the system has phase separated, you will see that a local configuration of a water molecule is either tetrahedrally coordinated or high density, and those in a properly equilibrated liquid are fluctuating all the time. That's why it's important not to get carried away by calling this, I call it a quote unquote mixture model. I don't want you to imagine that there are, I was doing a fit above the critical point. So what I'm fitting are the fraction of water molecules that have a given local environment, that's in a thermalized liquid, it's equilibrated, that is fluctuating all the time. Okay?
Yeah, thank you very much.
So we have a question from Ario Tosatti. Ario.
Yes, good morning, Pablo.
Hello.
A question about the nucleation between the two phases when you are below the critical point. What does that nucleation look like? Do we know anything about it from simulations or from experiment?
From simulations, we know that in a small system, which is what we've been able to simulate below the critical point, it is possible to have the system transition between low and high density phases. So it goes back and forth between low and high density phase. Of course, that's something that you can only see in a simulation. It's a finite size effect. And what you see happens, it happens very rapidly. All of a sudden, you see a local low density local environment that forms in the high density phase, and that immediately nucleates the overall low density phase. And so the system goes from a low density to a high density, and it just fluctuates back and forth. In experiment, it has not been seen. That's what everyone is looking for. There is indirect evidence, for example, the most recent by the group of Anders Nilsson, who did a isochoric quench of the glass phase and did femtosecond X-ray scattering and observed a discontinuity in the scattering spectrum, which he was able to assign to a transition from one phase to the other. But that's in the glassy phase, or almost close to the glassy phase. So we know what it looks like in the liquid in simulations. It has not been seen in experiments unambiguously. I hope I answered your question, Edio.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so if there are no other questions, let me remind Pablo that we have a session of exclusive question and answer with the students, which is a separate Zoom room. And so if there are no other questions.
So Antonello, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
I was told that session starts at 5:30 for you.
Yeah, it's in 20 minutes.
Yes. Okay. Very good.
Okay. I can meet you there in 20 minutes.
It's okay. A different Zoom link. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, you have
a
different invitation. Okay, so if there are no other questions, then I would really like to thank Pablo again for his, for his talk and kindly agreeing to, discuss
with us. Thank you. I'm the one who's grateful. Thank you very much.
And we are really looking forward for you to visit Trieste as soon as it will be possible.
Okay, very good.
Thanks, Pablo.
See you soon.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.